So it's my privilege now to introduce Daniela Zande from the Netherlands. You've got her biography on the website, you've seen that, so I'm not going to say anything about her. But she's a dear friend, good colleague, and she's got really exciting things to excite us with. So you're on.
I'm on. Oh my. Let's see what happens after lunch. One never knows. Thank you, David.
Okay. You're going over there, are you?
No, I'm going to stand here. I have something. Hopefully it will work. We'll see. Well, anyway, good afternoon. Many familiar faces from yesterday and some new faces. So for those of you who were at my masterclass yesterday, it will be a continuation. There will be some overlap, but not that much. For those who are new, I will give a tiny little bit of an introduction into appreciative inquiry, but it will also be in the slides, the PowerPoint presentation of yesterday. And what I want to do today is basically continue the conversation, and in the spirit of this meeting indeed, I also feel free to move into the directions that are new to me and where I have my own kind of puzzles and questions and no answers. And just see, or have answers, and just see where that might take us. Yeah. So this is the beautiful castle. Since we're now in competition with all kinds of different schools, this is the castle of Nyenrode Business University in the Netherlands, and you're all very welcome to visit when you're somewhere around Amsterdam, because that's where we're located. Something about my positioning in action research. I think that's important to know. We all come into action research, or we're exploring or thinking about getting into action research from different angles and different journeys through life. Mine is actually based on organization development. So I was in organization development, in management development, way before I got into action research. And I hold a chair in Nyenrode that's called Sustainable Organizational Development. So I come from the organizational development tradition into action research. And for those of you who've been around for a long while, you know, or have been reading the books, you know that basically OD and action research started together, completely intertwined. And I think we're coming back together right now. I have been interested, way before I became a professor, in the connections between practice and theory. I think that a lot of real interesting, powerful stuff is happening right on that edge between our theorizing and our practical work that we want to do and the kind of changes that we want to facilitate. And if it comes to the theoretical perspective, for those of you here that sit with maybe a PhD hat on or a faculty hat on, I'm very much interested in inductive qualitative research, and I do believe also in the role of theory to be proactive. I do think that we need new theory, new ways of knowing exactly at this time, and that's why I also think that action research is actually so powerful. Yesterday I spoke about my appreciative lens. So I tend to look at situations from the perspective of, okay, what's giving life here? Where are openings here for change? Where is the energy? Where is hope, perhaps? Where is dignity? That kind of questions. Appreciative inquiry, for some of us, it's seen as a form of dialogic organization development. And then it's brought into the same family as, for instance, World Cafe, Future Search, Open Space, all those kind of dialogic, participatory approaches to organizational change. And appreciative inquiry belongs to that family. But appreciative inquiry just as much belongs to the family of contemporary action research as it's being discussed, for instance, in the different handbooks of SAGE. Like the last version is from 2015. And as I said, I am somewhere in between, but more and more I'm basically focusing on action research. And then I take an appreciative stance. And for those of you who were there yesterday, my appreciation remains, but I also become more and more critical, and we'll talk about what I mean by critical. The main advantage for me to go back to the roots also of appreciative inquiry, which was meant to be action research with generative capacity, is that it forces me to do two things. If you look at facilitating change from an OD perspective, impacting change, then it's mainly a second person activity. It's the action cycle, you focus on a participatory process of change. And in the case of appreciative inquiry, appreciative participatory process of change. Now that I look at it from action research, it adds very explicitly the first person kind of awareness, and not only of me as a person and maybe as the main facilitator of processes, but of all the co-researchers in the room. So it adds the first person awareness, it adds the focus on what are maybe my blind spots, more so than even before, what is the kind of impact that I'm having with the questions that I ask, etc., etc. And this morning we were talking about ethical considerations, so that all comes into it, and it's not in the background, but more in the foreground. And it also allows me, invites me to, and the people involved, to get into third person work. So how might we, what we learn here today, how might we invite others to come into that conversation? How might we, if you sit here from a PhD perspective, for instance, do your dissertation work in ways that your theorizing can travel, and that we're not only producing very worthwhile, actionable knowledge for the here and now, but also making these new ways of thinking and new knowledge approachable and achievable for, and we're opening it up for audiences somewhere there and then that we don't even know about. So that's the main advantage for me, and then for you to know that I am one of the many people nowadays. I'm sure that half of this room will use that language also, more than half probably, maybe not. But in the Netherlands, all issues are wicked nowadays. The whole world is wicked. Maybe that's true, by the way. But it's about those issues that we really don't know how to handle and to navigate. I mean, transforming healthcare, the whole sustainability agenda, climate change, you name it. All those issues that are multi-actor, multi-factor, that we do not have evidence-based practice for, and that we basically have to muddle our way through, and therefore, just therefore in itself, need each other to figure it out, because nobody knows it by themselves. And I focus then on the social dimension, on what we then call social innovation, which is also kind of an emerging terrain with all kinds of different definitions, but I position myself somewhere there. I really believe in practice as the site of knowing. And I will get into it a little bit. I use the notion of generativity as a guiding value in my work, and I will discuss that. For this keynote, and we have an hour or so, I think. So some of the guiding questions, and maybe you have different guiding questions. The title is that it's about critical appreciation in action research. So for me, guiding questions is, as an action researcher, how can I be appreciative without being naive? And it's also about how can I be critical without being cynical? So how do I come from a constructionist background, social constructionist. We might be very good in deconstructing, and we might be really good in pointing to what's wrong in the world. But I find it important to also find energy and possibility to then do something about it. So critical without being cynical or nihilistic. Koen Bartels and Julia Wittmeyer, they run a track in the Interpretive Policy Analysis Conference that is going on, I think, starting also this week or next week. On action research, and they used the terminology that I really like. I was there last year. How to be critical and relational. And I will kind of get a little bit into that connection, that combination later on. And to me, how to be critical and relational is part and parcel of what Ken Gergen has introduced a long time ago as generative theorizing, because you can see it in the definition itself. It's to construct accounts of our world that challenge, that's the critical, the taken for granted conventions of understanding, and that's the relational, simultaneously invite us into new worlds of inquiry and action. And I think that kind of hits the core also of what we want to achieve as action researchers. It's not just to be critical and to put our finger on the unjust and the unsustainable, etc. It's also, and maybe predominantly also, our commitment and our ability to work with the people whose issues they are, to work towards betterment and improvement and transformation. So think about, maybe you have completely different questions, but they may be similar, but think, hold your questions in your mind and heart, wherever you want to hold them, when I'm continuing. One slide about the priest of inquiry, because that's my underground. I did my dissertation work at Case Western Reserve University, an organizational behavior department where David Cooperider and Suresh Srivastava, both were when I was a student. David Cooperider is still there, Suresh Srivastava passed away. They introduced it in their seminal article of 1987. They introduced the priest of inquiry as a form of action research, as action research with generative capacity. And it became, and I discussed it yesterday, also very much known as a strengths-based change methodology, and then the 4D cycle of discovery, dream, design, and destiny is what we normally follow. The underlying principles, I'm not going to discuss them in depth, but the whole idea, constructionist idea, that language really matters. So I'm always really focusing on language. We say that words create worlds. They're not mirroring worlds, but they create worlds. So it's important to be precise and maybe also original in the kind of language that we use for change. I'm always focusing on change also from an OD perspective. We talk about that inquiry is intervention. So there's no such a thing as doing diagnosis and then implementing. The first questions that we ask already start a change that we might want to see. Poetic, we can study whatever is alive in human systems, and everything is there, we know that. So it's a matter of what do we want to focus on. There's a lot of focus on the future imagery, because if we have aspiring images of the future, if we can use our imaginative mind, especially also now when we deal with all those wicked issues, if we cannot use the power of our imaginative mind, then we're kind of at a loss of where we might want to go. And I'm not saying that if we have an image of where we might want to go, that we will get there. But we need imagination for new alternatives, for new practice. So that's an important part. And the positive we're going to talk about, but the whole idea that it helps if you make connections that energize, that give you new inspiration to basically go through with what's always difficult and tiring process of change sometimes. So overall questions, what gives life? What are strength, pride, passion? Where do we find that? What works? That's a design question. They always ask themselves, designers, what works? And I think it's also a good question to have for action researchers, that whatever we're doing, that we ask ourselves the question, what's working here and how might we continue? And who are we at our best, both now and in the future? So that's a very brief introduction into appreciative inquiry. Now I want to make it personal, because I got introduced to appreciative inquiry when I was PhD student at Case already in 1995. I went to Cleveland, and what I write here, and I will read it, is a personal communication, a conversation started with David Cooperider just after I had been to an introductory appreciative inquiry workshop in Taos, and the Taos Institute, for instance. That's where a lot of appreciative inquiry work was done in the past. This is what I literally wrote at that time. Where a rose blooms, I said, sharing its beauty with the world, and then loses its petals, becomes ugly, but feeds the soil for new life to come. There's meaning even in suffering, and life and death are intertwined. Why then, and we did that at the workshop, why do we talk about people who are skeptical towards appreciative inquiry as the naysayers that need to be taken care of? Why do people have to suspend their worries where worries show they care? Isn't idealism found precisely under the surface of where people are the most cynical? To me, appreciative inquiry is like a bunch of colorful balloons that go up in the sky and are lost for heaven when we can't ground ourselves in also the misery of the world. The more I move towards appreciative inquiry, the more I personally feel a need to also face the ugly. And yes, then I do embrace the appreciative stance. That was almost 20 years ago. And I don't know how it is for people here in the room, but I often find that at the moment that you get invited to stand on your appreciative leg, that somehow that also brings forth the shadow. And there is quite some articles that write about the shadow of appreciation. Somehow we have a sense that we need to balance. And I'm sharing this also to show that to take an appreciative stance is a personal choice. And it is a recurrent choice. Because I made that choice there 20 years ago, but a couple of years after that we had 9/11. And I know these people here from the States, we had 9/11. And 4 weeks or 6 weeks after 9/11 happened, we were going to have the first international appreciative inquiry conference in Baltimore. It was like 6 weeks later, if. It was only a couple of weeks since it was possible again to fly, and people were going to come in from all over the world. And in the end, there were like 600 participants in that first international conference. But I remember there again, and other people as well, that we had to make that choice. Am I being naive in this kind of a world? When we saw, and especially I was teaching at that time at CASE when it happened, so it was really, really impactful. Am I being naive if at this time in this world I take an appreciative stance, which basically deeply also means a trust in the human goodness, a trust in the potential of people to learn, not only the potential, the willingness. It's the underlying OD kind of values. Am I being naive? And again I decided, no, I want to, maybe I need to. I need to keep this belief in the possibility of the good in humankind, and then also obviously in our capacity somehow to work together towards world betterment. And again, nowadays, in this time when everything, you know, I don't even know where to look and you see trouble. Again, it's kind of, okay, where do I stand? So it's not an easy kind of choice. For me, at least. But it is the only choice that eventually I feel personally, and that can be different for all of us in this room, that I feel personally I have to make in order to do the kind of work that I want to do, and maybe even to be, quite frankly, to be able to continue living on this planet. So. This is one of the discussions we've had from the beginning, and this is also in the first article, there's a dichotomy between looking at problems and looking at the appreciative side. Organization as a problem to be solved or organization as a miracle to be embraced. And you can see it's kind of funny because it's both sides of the same coin. So what do we choose and how do we deal with this kind of dichotomy if we even want to think in terms of dichotomies? We're used, trained often to look at the problematic and never throw that away. The invitation is to also look at with a spirit of inquiry, a sense of wonder at what is working and what is possible in even the most difficult circumstances. This is a slide that I used yesterday as well, just to give you a little bit of background. So appreciative inquiry, this the appreciative came out of the idea of, was a focus on generativity, what gives life, a life-centric approach to inquiry. But at some point we needed to prove, Dave Cooper got a need to prove to the founders, the sponsors in organizations, new projects, whatever, that it worked. And how do you prove in a constructionist kind of approach that it works? We didn't measure anything, maybe we looked at language. But then at the same time, we got this whole stream coming up of the positive and everything, people using the word positive. Positive psychology, positive organizational scholarship, all looking on purpose in the continuum of deficit to basically proactive and excellence, looking at the side of how can we move beyond efficiency and effectiveness to excellence, to thriving, to talent, to all those kinds of notions. That was at that point becoming very popular. And obviously, because that's basically embedded in a much more positivist paradigm, they measured. They do studies in for instance, in Michigan, and some of you are in education may know about those studies. They, for instance, do studies that they say, okay, if students keep a gratitude journal, so every day write something now that they were grateful about, then if you want to see the effects of that, you can put the hand of somebody in a bucket of ice water. And physiology, I can't really pronounce the word correctly, but the kind you can see that people that have a gratitude journal will recover quicker than people that don't have that. That kind of studies and all kinds of other survey studies on very interesting topics like resilience, but they do it from a positivist angle, not from a constructionist angle. And that, at some point, the whole notion of positive emotions, etc., helped to prove that the appreciative inquiry worked. So that's why we got onto the bandwagon of the positive. And then people start to critique it. Now we're back to, no, it's not about the positive. It's about the generative. It's about what gives life. And that's an important distinction that I personally always try to point out. I got into action research in the Netherlands. The first organization, well, the second organization actually, was a healthcare organization where indeed it was mentioned this morning. Instead of working with very, you mentioned it, instead of working with very large groups, I started to work with small groups and then maybe again with large groups. It's not an either or, it's about. But I did my action research in healthcare and then through that, there's a lot of things that I learned that I want to share, and I became more critical about the potential, the kind of notion that we have that if we only can talk differently, the world will change through that. That's the constructionist. Words create worlds. So if we talk differently, then obviously we will have new behavior and started to think a little bit different. I started to really see the limitations of those kinds of constructionist underpinnings and saying, no, talk is not enough. We also need to act. And action and talk and action need to be intertwined. And that's where I really got my grounding in the action research approach. This is what I shared yesterday. If we talk about an appreciative stance to action research, then we look at action research with generative capacity. And so it's very similar to action research with sometimes a little bit of a different flavor to it. So in the second person, that's where we focus on organizational change in my practice, which is working with the co-researchers, having maybe sometimes the whole system in the room, as we say, a representation of the whole system in the room, and together figuring out, okay, what is our future? Where do we want to move towards? And what needs to be done for that? So it's a participatory process of inquiry as intervention. The inquiry, the moment that we start asking each other questions and we start to get into conversation, we're already changing. That's the underlying idea. Dialogic OD, family of all the approaches that really believe in the power of conversation. And inquiry with organizational participants as co-researchers. In the first person, we have this notion of personal awareness, etc. But in appreciative inquiry, we take it one step further. We talk about the spirit of inquiry. It's a very important kind of notion that comes from both David Copperider and Suresh Srivastava, the notion of openness and wonder, and also really a reference for life. Really, and that's where this notion came into, seeing an organization, seeing a human system as a miracle to embrace, the miracle and mystery of organizational life. Seeing how things are really working instead of looking at what's not working. Having an open eye to the beautiful moments, even whether it's tiny little small of human interaction and everything that brings out the most noble possibilities of our existence in the workplace, our existence in our family life, our existence in the community, etc. So it's about reference for life, and also, I said this yesterday, true appreciation is to join the language and the reality of the other. Developing generative knowledge, well, and here you said a very good thing, that for you, basically, we make it too much into dissemination. And it should not only be about now we're going to write it up and we see how it's evocative and how it travels. It's widening the circle of inquiry, basically. And you can see here that most of it here, other than the relational sensitivity, that will be like the systemic understanding as well, it is mostly focused, what I write here, on what we do as academics also. To write, but then to write yet in a different style. Not to write to say what is true, but to write to continue the conversation. I find that very important. So to keep asking questions also in our writing. And ideally, we would be able, and in some of the journals that's possible, that it doesn't look like it's all cast in stone, and that we figured it out for once and forever, but that we have all those questions, and it's an invitation to continue. But that, in a nutshell, it's also in the presentation of yesterday. Generativity as guiding value is important. Within Appreciative Inquiry, Shervis Bush talks about the combination of original ideas so that we get new ideas. So originality, creativity are important notions. But not only that it's a nice idea, the people say, oh, it's a nice idea, but that basically it also gives us the energy to work on it, to continue and to make it practice, to move it into practice. Generative processes of relating, and you can see that I have, like David Cooper, I have been really influenced in my work by Ken Gergen. Some of you may really know him, founder of social constructionism, the chair of the board of the Taos Institute, that's an international group of people that look also in healthcare practice and education, but from a constructionist perspective. One of his last books is called Relational Being. One of the biggest puzzles for me is how can we, with our northern mind, and I think most of us sit here with a northern mind, how on earth can we really develop a much more relational sensitivity? If it comes to those issues of sustainability, as long as I think that if I'm in the Netherlands and I get my green electricity, I'm fine and it doesn't really matter what's happening somewhere in Brazil or in China. As long as we think, and I think we're being basically that kind of taken for grantedness is being shaken from all directions, but as long as we think that, there is no hope for our global system, our global village. So how on earth, in our language, in our mindsets, in our way of working, can we move beyond this notion of individuals as entities that may need to stretch out? All our psychology, everything is based on that, may need and find ways to reach out to other people. How can we turn that around and say what really matters is the relational? How do we make that primary? That's really important, and that's what Ken, for instance, writes about, and then he talks about generative process of relating as those in which new and enriching potentials are open through the flow of interchange. How we interact, how we relate, influences the kind of thought that we might basically create with one another, and the other way around. They're intertwined. And then for those of you who are also into academic discourse, generative theory accounts to challenge the status quo and invite us into new worlds of meaning and action. What does that mean? It means transformation instead of understanding, prediction, and control. Totally different scientific paradigm. I've forgotten your name. But this, from where you come, that may be a bit different, right? If you said that in agriculture, you basically look at more the quantitative kind of approaches. Now, this is taking it two steps in another direction to some extent, because it's rather than telling it like it is, the focus is on telling it like it might become, which is important if we also in agriculture want to work towards sustainability. And knowledge creation is a social activity. It's not an individual activity in that sense. It's not, as one of my colleagues always so nicely says, it's not what happens between our ears. Knowledge is created between our noses. Mm-hmm. It's a social endeavor to create knowledge. social activity that enables the construction of something new. To put it yet differently, if you talk about generative processes of relating, it's the invitation that we say, okay, we experience generativity, and it would be nice for yourselves to take a moment. Well, I don't think we have a moment now, but to take a moment somewhere in the coming days and to kind of see for yourself, when do I really feel generative? Generative as, for instance, a sense of being alive, sense of open-endedness, a sense of seeing new possibilities, seeing openings. When do I really feel alive? What are my experiences of generativity? When we engage, as I say here, in open-ended processes of inquiry that are triggered, encouraged, and sustained by our relational encounters in an interconnected, spirited world. How do we sit in this web of life, this animated web of life, and when do we come and feel alive the most? And you can see, Victor, this is for you. This is an image of Schiermonnikoog. Whenever I feel that I feel the most connected when I don't see a human soul. sometimes I need to go to, and heaven forbid if there's somebody else on that beach. But it's different for all of us. But nature is important to me. And company is important to me. And again, to promote Nairo, that's our rose garden. Anyway, so generativity is an important, you can see it. I was talking about it yesterday and also today. It's an important concept for me. It kind of goes beyond dichotomies of positive and negative. And it helps me to have a sense every time in relationships to get unstuck, because we also know many examples of relationships and processes that are not generative. In organizations, when somebody comes into the corridor, all of a sudden we need to make a left or right turn. Meetings where we sit that we go, oh my God, can I please hope that this meeting will be over soon? And we all go through this 10 points on the agenda going like, oh, here we go again. That's not what we're talking about. Here we talk about the kind of relationships and moments that we also all know, that when something unexpectedly happens, when you get to know somebody better and different and anew, and at the same time come up with miraculously interesting new insights. We know those, we have them both in our repertoire. And here we're looking, and sometimes we also work on how can you get out of the stuckness of degenerative cycles. And maybe it's very small hints in conversations when you can give it a turn and move in a new direction. Anyway. This is kind of ambiguous terrain. We use all these kind of words. We use reflection, reflexivity. And I think sometimes those semantics, you have to make your own. Same, I would say, for action research. The way we hear, we use all kinds of different words. And sometimes it helps to really understand one another and to also see, okay, but if I do participatory action research, then I have some notions, just like I have notions when I say I do appreciative action research. But sometimes it also works against ourselves and our own kind of work. This is where I tried to unravel those different distinctions. And you may say, well, it works different for me, and that's perfectly fine. But the question is how to create collaborative capacity. I'm always into that. So also in the field of sustainability, I say we have technology, we have the intellectual savvy, but where it falls flat on this planet at the moment, everywhere we look in issues of governance, etc., is our collaborative capacity. How are we going to move? And the Paris deal was actually seemed to be a big step forward. How are we going to move together? How are we creating and enhancing our collaborative capacity? So how to create collaborative capacity, new knowledge, and new ways of knowing to navigate the pressing issues of our time. And then reflection, obviously, is important. And in a way, you can say, you know, and people like Anne Cunliffe, I think she makes that kind of distinction. You can say reflection, and I do that with my management students, my executive students. Reflection can be on the action. So we are out of our normal work. We're coming to a setting like Nairo or a setting like this. And we're now reflecting on the work that we're doing at home, or we're reflecting on our processes. It's on the action, it's away from daily practice. It can be like an observant of our own work, and it might be more or less objective. And looking at, okay, what in hindsight, what did happen? It's making sense of what happened. Reflexivity, and yesterday I used the definition of Anne Canliffe, who says reflexivity is to question that what we take for granted. But reflexivity also to me, and to her by the way, has a much more a connotation of that in the action. Like in Holland, we really want to have, this management wants to have the healthcare professionals to basically be able to reflect in action, to have that kind of attitude, to decide on the spot what is the right decision to take here in taking care of this lady or this man. What is it that we need to do? Do we follow the protocols? Do we something else? We need to be able in the action to decide what might be right. So in the action, inside unfolding practice, much more from an engaged kind of perspective, not out of it, but in it, and therefore maybe also more critical. Really trying to also see in also the ethical implications, etc. And then generativity, if we want to make that kind of distinction, to me is about transforming action. It's looking for wiggle room, also in daily practice. There may be, we always think that daily practice routine is a routine. And we forget that even if something feels like a routine, we always make decisions to uphold that routine. So we can also make decisions to shift that routine, and that happens. Yesterday, I don't know whether he's here today. Yesterday there was somebody who said this kind of fatigue, change fatigue. Change fatigue happens from a perspective that we want to do big change, planned kind of linear change, where management is in charge. But if we look at daily work, we find that there is wiggle room and people use that wiggle room. Otherwise, organizations, there will be no generativity. Organizations will die. Systems will die. You need to energize and re-energize. So wiggle room for change, much more of an activist kind of approach, and also using our imaginative mind to be able to see and to work towards something that does not yet exist. So, that just as a little intermezzo. I presented the previous slide a while ago when I was in Sweden, and some of us here in the room, Mary and David and Victor and probably some others, are familiar with this work. This is the work of the Skaraborg Hospital, and I pronounce it totally incorrect, but that's when I read it from in my Dutch kind of mind. And Chalmers Institute of Technology, Chalmers University of Technology. And for all of you here who are involved in healthcare, it's an interesting story. Just like everywhere else, also in West Sweden, this is already like 10, 12 years ago, I think, they had to get into healthcare reform and specifically focus on integrated care. And you need to know that in Sweden, they have the hospitals, they have primary care units, and they have the municipalities that also take care of home care. So there's basically three different kind of entities that have to work together towards providing health care. And they said we need integrative care, and basically the government said that, and then in the Skaraborg Hospital they picked that up. And they started with a process that they called the Urian Project. And what that meant is that they took the idea of a fictive kind of patient, Urian, and to basically see what kind of pathway, and this is a long time ago, nowadays you all do it, the patient journeys, etc. But what is the pathway of an elderly patient in Western Sweden through our healthcare system? And early on they said we can do that from the hospital, but let's do it in an integrated group. Let's also get people on board from the primary care units and from the municipality. And they started to work on this little project where they mapped the pathway using quality improvement tools and then started to see, okay, what are all the areas where we can make improvement? That's nothing for all of you. You go like, yeah, duh, we do that every day, right? But what was so special in hindsight now, so many years later, is from here they developed at some point the idea of mobile care units, where for the 2% most fragile patients, they no longer come to the hospital. The specialist and the nurses go to the patients at home. And really, so they basically started to reorganize for healthcare, although it all started within the normal hierarchical structures. And they can really show that it has huge impact, their way of working, taking the patient really serious, not the disease, not the patient, but the full human being with the whole kind of system around it. Patient as a tractor, as they say, and that has really transformed healthcare to the extent that from very small start, nowadays, the whole of Sweden at the national level is adopting their approach. Much more to say about it, those of you who are interested. I will just show you a name of somebody, and that's Livergren, Svante Livergren. If you Google him, Google Scholar, this is a well-documented case, a really well-documented case. Also in the action research literature, for instance, in the last handbook of action research, there's a chapter about exactly this same case. But we've been looking at it a while ago. This is for an action research cookbook, as we call it, that may come out soon, also maybe a web-based book. But what we often say when we start really small, that it's difficult to basically bring it to the larger scale. Or if we bring it to the larger scale, maybe difficult to give it enough depth to really be kind of transformative. But here they did both. Very briefly, they took a systemic worldview. To me, it's important also for all of us as action researchers, as an invitation, to take a systemic worldview. Even if you do something at a very small scale, to do that with an understanding of how that might fit in within the whole system. That's what they did there. So they work very small, but always with the whole healthcare system in mind. And if you have that, then you can look at what are pivotal moments. What are moments where I really need to be present to give the unfolding process a twist? What are leveraging mechanisms where change that is unfolding and happening anyway can just take away some of the obstacles or just give it a little push? And be very alert to that, because obviously nobody is in charge of the whole system, so you always have to find smart ways for small change. Underlying principles, as I said, they really, from that systemic worldview, they said we take the patient as an attractor through the whole system. So that was always the commonality for all the conversations. They took a learning approach. All of you were working with Lean in healthcare. There's hope here. Because they did it as well. They started, Svante is quality improvement manager. So they used all the basic tools of quality management, but they always did it with a learning kind of philosophy behind it. So not on only focusing on efficiency, but focusing on what are we learning here together? What are we assessing? And seeing inquiry as a generative process. Nobody knew exactly what would happen at the beginning. It started as a project, and then it got a long, continuous kind of life, for instance. Practices, as I said, quality improvement and measurement, generative leadership, a kind of leadership that is shared. So not only Svante, everybody involved can take on leadership activities. The kind of leadership that looks at how can we connect different levels in the system, how can we bridge differences, how can we often do nothing but show up at those critical pivotal moments and really give it kind of a little push. How can we both be intellectual, but especially relational, intelligent, and how can we be authentically present in those processes? Organizing for development, just as an example, those three basic different care units, entities, at some point you said, let's stop, just imagine, let's stop our internal reimbursements. Just to give space. We're all the same system. Let's just give space for improvement. And, inclusive practice-based dialogues. Much more to say about it, but I just wanted to bring it in the room here as an example of working at all these kinds of levels, what I discussed yesterday. Looking at what gives life. getting into a process that's open-ended, but where connectedness is a very important quality all the time. Working on a topic not only of mutual concern, but of high mutual concern. Really where the passion is, and that's easy in a healthcare system. I mean, I work sometimes with people from financial institutions, and especially a couple of years ago, it was not so easy to say, where is our passion? What are we about? But in healthcare, there's always this commonality. So if you can really pinpoint that, then this whole idea of that we do not have time, etc., falls away. They have learning platforms where people talk across, third level, talk across, always with the patient and those projects in mind. Microsystem as a starting point, I really believe in that, the primary process. Being pragmatic, what works, also using quantitative measures. Being reflexive, emancipatory, and rebellious. And this is where I get into. That was a question. There was a question yesterday. From where? What are you going to say about the critical and the appreciative? So let's get into that. Since last year, I worked together with Nicoline, or year before, Nicoline Montesano Montessori, and she does action research in education. She is from the Montessori family. And we met when we were in a meeting of like, I don't know whether it was 25 years or longer, but the celebration of critical discourse analysis. So the founders of the field of critical discourse analysis were there, and Nicoline studied with Ferklo on her topic for her dissertation work. So they were all there. And she comes from that tradition, and I came in from an interest in discourse, but from an appreciative bend. And at some point I said, well, this is interesting. You're all talking about your legacy and the trouble that nothing has changed in the world. They know everything about discourse, right? I said, why don't you use that to make change happen? And Nicoline was there, and she was the only one in the room who actually, from a critical discourse analysis perspective, does action research. And then does participatory action research from the critical tradition. And she's done work also in Mexico from the critical tradition of what happens in South America. So that's where we got together, based on our interest in discourse and also in action research and really working towards world betterment. But then you can see in how we work, we're looking for how can we create egalitarian research spaces. And yesterday I mentioned it, it's also good for you to know that Nicoline comes from a Montessori school background, and I have a background in my education from when I was 5 years old until I was 17 years old in a school that's based on Quaker values. So for us both, egalitarian, horizontal spaces are very logical. When we basically presented it last year at the Interpretive Policy Analysis Conference, people are looking at us like, horizontal? What are you talking about? That's not possible, and we don't even think it's needed. But anyway, that's what we try to work on. For me, it's to overcome a big blind spot in appreciative inquiry, namely that we don't really have open eyes towards the power dynamics that play out somewhere in the shadow of appreciation. We think that if we put people together in a room, we have a nice topic, and we have good questions, and there's 500 people in the room sitting at tables like this, they speak with equal voice. Well, that's naive. So how to be critical and relational? So it's about engagement, to join, and to join the language and the reality of the others, and then perhaps interrupt it. We want to stretch it, but not overstretch it. It's about emancipation. That's a word that we use a lot, also in participatory action research and also in OD, etc. But it's emancipation out of institutional stuckness. We're all stuck. If we talk about that we need to develop new games for a sustainable world, we're all stuck in the current unsustainable kind of habits and practices. So it's not about that we emancipate. We're automatically looking like this. That we emancipate people there. We all need to be emancipated. So that gives me the possibility to be more humble and to be more patient, etc. So it's that combination. So, and how can we then bring together heterogeneous groups So children, teachers, you name it. Nicoline has done research where at some point they went, the teachers looked into, okay, what are bumpy moments in the classroom education, in the interaction with the children, but they sometimes turned to the children and said, please give me feedback. Those kids over there, please give me feedback, and probably use different words. But in those bumpy moments, probably use different words, what is it that you saw me doing? So asking the kids to give feedback, to give their perspective on what was happening in those moments that we got stuck. So it is possible to bring all the voices in, to speak in equal voice from different perspectives, and then take steps. Those kids over there, one of the research initiatives of Nicoline, they're basically having a conversation there on how to create a classroom environment together that would be totally inclusive also, because there was also the whole study was about these children that, for instance, are on the autism spectrum or whatever. How can we work together to make it a good classroom climate for all of us? They discussed it themselves. What kind of rules, etc. So heterogeneous groups, where all can speak in equal voice, is that possible and how can we do that? And then we both say it's a political act for us as action researchers to create the conditions in which that might be possible. We have to find ways, and that's why I find, for instance, Svante Livergren so powerful. He uses his measurements, not to say this is the fact, but if he can say we have 80% less unnecessary visits to the emergency room because of what we're doing, that helps him to create mandate to continue the process. So it's a political act. We need to speak the language of the people that can create the conditions in which we can work in those heterogeneous settings, in which the healthcare professionals do get the time to also reflect on their work, where they can work together with maybe their directors to be both vulnerable in seeing, okay, what needs to be done here, what could be done differently. So it's also about safety and trust and all those kinds of things. And that can, and then it can be helpful, and that's what Nicoline does, to basically have all kinds of structuring activities that give the kind of, that create in organizational development language the container, the space in which research inquiry can happen. So that's about topic choice and framing, doing that together. It's about translating an overall topic into questions that are basically of value for the different kinds of practices that you even find in one and the same institution. Like in a hospital, care, cure, it's all different. So what are the really typical questions for maybe even at a team level that we want to work with? And how can we come up with a semi-structured research design that gives people enough sense of that we're not just doing something silly, but also that it's open enough to allow for the kind of surprise of the continuous inquiry that we want to get into together. I'm at time. Let me see, I'm almost, oh, I have two more slides. Is that possible?
Yeah.
Was too slow. In one of our papers, we talk about the silence of emergence, comparing it with the silence of oblivion. So oblivion, and it's all basically being negated, etc. But how can we move? This is another picture, Victor, of the island that you have to go to. But what can we do to go beyond the hectic kind of circumstances, to find the space and then also create the quality of dialogue in which this new thought that we so drastically need might emerge? I'm talking about doing, designing, dialoguing, and stillness. So we're talking about topics of high mutual concern, and Paulo Freire called that generative themes, basically. So things that really, really matter. Designing the secure and level research space, and I find that it helps to level the playing ground by using humor, and also by showing, for me, when I facilitate, showing my own vulnerability. Both of those things. Focusing on microdynamics in daily work and zooming in on, because you can't zoom on everything, zooming in on what Schotter has called perplexed moments, or what Nicoline called bumpy moments, or what in my case in the healthcare organization, people started to appreciate their dilemmas in their daily work. But those moments where something has really happened, now I don't have to tell you that you all do that, right? So it's kind of zooming in on perplexed moments and have a conversation about that. And then dialoguing, and this is the most difficult, I think, and maybe for some of you not, but this is really my search. How do we go beyond instrumental dialogue? How can we have really deep, insightful conversations, for instance, with healthcare professionals who meet only once every 6 weeks, have 10 issues on the agenda, have never learned how to really conduct meetings, and have their children already waiting for them in the schoolyard? That's the reality, right? So how do we get into that non-instrumental dialogue that Buber talks about? The true meeting and stories help a lot. Thoughtful questions help a lot. Attentive listening is also communication, can help a lot. And finding fresh vocabulary. And then Cunliffe again, who talks about the poetics of inquiry. That's not only intellectual, it's intuitive, it's embodied. And it's bringing in sense of wonder. And then to bring Judy Marshall into the room, I think one of the highest qualities that we should practice is basically, especially also as action researchers who facilitate processes, is the capacity of not knowing. Mm-hmm. Letting go of control, letting go of the need of our expertise. Just meeting in that space of not knowing, because on the edge of knowing and not knowing, that's where we find openings for creative change. That's what I wanted to say.
Thank you.